dwells fully in heavy editions of the spreading media. A theorist of the editorial act, Paul's principal arguments are brought together in his monographs, Securing the Past, 2009, and Biography of the Book, 2013. Prior to coming to Loyola at the beginning of 2015, Paul worked for 30 years at the University of New South Wales in Australia. Then he served as founding director of the Australian Scholarly Edition Centre, 1993-2005, as head of the English Department, 2001-2003, and then for the last 5 years at that university, had a research-only role at the Australian Research Council of Conservation. I mentioned his books of Creative Class, Conservation in Art, Architecture, and Literature, published by Cambridge UP in 2009. It won the Society for Textual Scholarship's Premier Award as the best book of editorial theory 2019. Paul later served as president of the US-based society during 2014. Fellow of the Australian Academy of Humanities since 1998, Paul served as the general editor of the Academy of Editions of Australian Digital Service in 10 volumes and was chair of his English section. He received the Centenary Medal of the Commonwealth of Australia for services to the study of literature in 2003.
Textual criticism and the study of adaptation, and the subtitle is Ned Kelly's graciously ushered many of the illustrations today that I'll show will indeed illustrate this bibliographic afterlife. It's but a short step from that question to the broader question, at least for those cases where it is relevant, of studying the work's participation within a larger folkloric tradition. And here we encounter questions central to the adaptation study. My case study centres around the story of the Australian bushranger Ned Kelly. His story is ultimately linked, in common with that of all other social bandits, to the legend of Robin Hood. As with the others, Kelly lived a life that was brutal, squalid, and short, yet it gave rise, in a folkloric way, to a remarkable series of works that were adaptations of one another. The first I want to talk about is not generally understood as a variant of the Kelly story, but once we take its reception, I'm referring to Rolf Boldewood's novel, Robbery Under Arms, a bushranger novel. It first appeared in Sydney as a serial during 1882. Robbery Under Arms went on to become an Empire classic, selling 500,000 copies, mainly from the 1890s to the 1910s. By the 1930s, interest was declining, and its publisher, Macmillan, decided to cut it adrift. However, the work went on unexpectedly to enjoy, as you see in the moment, I should say I can't click these slides absolutely the level of my text here. But you'll get the drift, so don't be anxious about that. So the work went on, as I say, to enjoy a second bibliographic life after World War II, when it spoke to a new generation of Australians, many of them ex-servicemen, evidently longing for the endorsement of their recent wartime experiences. They were looking back to the cultural nationalism in Australia of the 1890s. In that decade, and associated with the Sydney Bulletin, the qualities of the bushman began to be mythicised as the constrictions of city life began for the first time imaginatively to rot. But the myth took some decades to reach the So, in the late 1940s, after the war, and 1950s, Robbery Under Arms was read as a celebration of the bushman. Its narrator's frequent moralising about crime, an essential ingredient for Rorschach's time and composition, as you saw in the early 1880s, was seen as regrettable by the 1950s, and better off ignored. But in the 1880s, by contrast, reviews show that the novel had been read as both a romance and a work of colonial history, documenting a way of life that was already passing. The story itself is a first-person narrative, spoken by Dick Marston, an attractive, semi-literate, outdoors, but basically decent young man, the son of an ex-convict selector, or small landowner. Dick has been tempted into a life of crime. He speaks in the demonic voice of his peer group. He is not interpreted by the formalities of narrate. So the novel starts like this, I'll read out the first few sentences. My name's Dick Marston, Sydney side native. I'm 29 years old, 6 feet in my stocking soles, 13 stone weight. Pretty strong and active with it, so to say. I don't want to blow, not here anyway, but it takes a good man to put me on my back, to stand up to me with the gloves or the naked mortals. I can write anything. Anything that's ever lacked. Swim like a musk duck and track like a mild blackfellow. Most things that a man can do, I'm up to, and that's all about it. As I lift myself now, I can feel the muscles swell on my arm like a cricket ball, in spite of everything. The creation of this voice was an innovation. It allowed Boldewood to explain what the newspapers had been editorialising about since the 1860s. No one was surprised when ex-convicts turned to crime. But why would freeborn settlers like Dick Marston find a life of bushranging more attractive than one of honest toil, given that the colonies, unlike Britain itself, offered opportunities aplenty? The voice created the space for an answer. The voice was the answer, one that amply acknowledged conventional pieties, for Dick, had I read on. writing his account when he's about to be hanged, but could express, but the voice could express idiomatically and with zest the countervailing attractions of healthy and energetic outdoor life, freedom from domestic responsibilities, the horseback heroics, the loyalty of nature, the defiance and courage in the life of the bushranger. No wonder the novel was attractive to its first audiences. Undoubtedly, the voice liberated Baldwin's own imagination. Baldwin was a magistrate and a conservative gentleman. And for the men of the 1940s, it would confirm qualities that had sustained them during the war. Physically toughened by outback conditions, colonial men had, ever since the Boer War in 1900, been seen in Britain as embodying a remedy for the physical deterioration that was the fate of the underfed, shorter, working First World War, especially politically, in 1915, confirmed both reputations. Manhood was being clipped and hedged in at home as the same group. Charles Dickens had sent an early signal of this in the novels. Think of the frustrated inventor Daniel Joyce, or the emotionally emasculated Arthur Clennam in Little Dorrit, serialised in the mid-1850s. D.H. Lawrence's Whole Earth, jumping 70 years, can be seen as another later response. His last novel, Lady Chatterley's Lover in 1928, offers a daring connection of the emotional to the physical emasculation of Clifford Chatterley. Lord Baden-Powell's contemporaneous scouting movement, Boy Scout movement, was all about redressing the problem by starting early, with boys extolling the virtues of healthy outdoor living. And in his manual for Rover Scouts, the more senior scouts, published in the early 1920s, his examples of manhood are the Canadian backwoodsman and the Australian or New Zealand bushman. The idea worked its way through the culture. The young heroine, for instance, the young heroine of Mary Grant Bruce's novel for children, Peralta, 1941, the young heroine is being sent to Australia from Britain after the outbreak of World War II. She, quote, had thought of Australia vaguely as a large pink blob on the map, which produced cricketers, wool, apples, and an uncommonly fierce and free and easy type of soldier. So it ought not to be surprising in retrospect that between 1947 and 1954, four new editions, that's the first one, four new editions of Robbery Under Arms appeared, and countless new impressions followed. Two films were produced in 1957 and 1985, by which time the novel was proving useful as an icon of the new wave of Australian nationalism in the lead-up to that country's bicentenary celebrations in 1988. The successive dust jacket designs reflected the changing appropriations of this work in the post-war period. What I discovered, to my surprise, as I was preparing a scholarly edition of Robbery Under Arms, and started to look beyond the early versions of the work towards its adaptations and its wider cultural functioning, was its connection to Ned Kelly. Baldwin did record in his diary for 1879 a grudging but nevertheless genuine admiration of the stylishness of one of Ned Kelly's raids, and he began to write the novel in 1882, about 18 months after Kelly was hanged. But the novel itself is set earlier in the 1850s and draws on Bushranger's subject matter from the 1860s rather than on the Ned Kelly story itself. The curious thing I found is that Robbery Under Arms and the various cultural inflections of the Ned Kelly story have bibliographically, theatrically, and filmographically weaved themselves around one another since the early 90s. It was this that necessitated the invoking of an overarching folkloric tradition. One legend, two story types. Ned Kelly's hanging in Melbourne in 1880 brought out elaborate displays of grief. At least 30,000 people signed a petition for a reprieve, and fascination with the phenomenon he represented led many in Melbourne to pay their sixpences to go and see his brother Jim and sister Kate Kelly upon the stage on the night of the hanging. The authorities closed it down the next day, Within weeks, the two were in Sydney, thought to be a safer bet, with Ned's horse called Music and also Kate's horse appearing on stage. Doubtless, viewers of these spectacles read them in terms of the tradition of Dick Turpin and his famous horse Black Bess. And behind Dick Turpin, of course, was the mythical figure of Robin Hood. Ned Kelly had, in fact, been captured on the stage well before he'd been captured in the flesh. After his killing of three well-armed policemen who were hunting him at Skinny Bar Creek in 1878, a hasty rewrite of an existing play was retitled and on the stage within weeks. And in 1880, while the police were showing great ineptitude in catching the Kelly gang despite heavy expenditure on the chase, a farce called Catching the Kellys and a burletta appeared on the Melbourne stage. After 1880, the authorities banned performances of the various plays about Kelly that emerged. When Robbery Under Arms became popular following its appearance in that cheap green format that that you saw earlier, Boldenwood soon gave permission for a play adaptation. It was a great success from 1890 and would be a standard part of the repertoire until the 1910s. Part of its popularity was its transparent adaptation of elements of the Kelly gang story, even though it was an stage adaptation of Robbery Under Arms. The Kelly gang story, which though, as I said, which though suppressed on stage, had nevertheless become legendary in the popular culture. One such real-life event that made its way into the Robbery Under Arms play was the Ned Kelly incident, when drunken trooper Fitzpatrick went to the Kelly house to arrest Ned's brother Dan on a charge of horse stealing, probably molested their sister Kate Kelly, and was shot in the wrist by Ned. Promised not to prosecute, but soon after had Ned, his brother and mother charged with attempted murder. The adapter of Boldenwood's novel for the play overlooked the author's own darker adaptation of the same incident. In the novel, police bounty hunters have been harassing Dick's mother and sister Eileen. When Eileen is in danger of being raped, Dick's father, who has been looking on from behind cover, becomes incensed and lures them into a trap where all four are shot, two of them in cold blood. There is no romance in Boldenwood's version of the shooting, only calculated violence. Fitzpatrick's incident in Kelly's life was in April 1878. It was the last straw. See if I can push on a little bit. I'm taking still through the many versions, the many productions, I should say, of many previous Robbery Under Arms. That's indicating the 1985 Sam Neill version. So the Fitzpatrick incident was in April 1878. It was the last straw for the 24-year-old Ned Kelly, who had already served two jail sentences and attempted to stay out of trouble. From then on, he was on the run with his gang. His murder of the three pursuing policemen Skinny Bar Creek followed. Their two daring and well-planned robberies at Euroa in Victoria and across the border at Chiribri in New South Wales. From the proceeds of these robberies, the Kelly gang families and their sympathisers benefited. Then there was the gang's last defiant stand against the police and Rowan in the armour, as you'll see in a minute, that they had fashioned from steel mouldboards of ploughs, followed by Ned's capture, trial and hanging. To be as game as Ned Kelly became a byword in the Australian colonies for courage and defiance, and it persists till this day, and he remains a contentious figure. By 1898, it had become feasible once again to risk putting the Kelly gang story on stage. Although the first script of 1898 does not survive, it is clear from playbills. It's clear from playbills that the actor Reg Reed, who had played Trooper O'Hara in the 1890 Robbery Under Arms stage adaptation, had the structure of that play in mind as he wrote the Kelly Gang play script, and that he copied into it from his side, that is his part script of the stage Robbery Under Arms, a comic subplot involving Irish troopers and their dealings with the timid, elderly Miss Euphrosyne Aspen. In this way, wonderful name, in this way, versions of the stage Robbery Under Arms subplot made their way into the various stage adaptations of the Kelly gang that followed Reg Reed's adaptation, including Arnold Denham's, which is the earliest extant version. So the various adapters is the manuscript of Denham's adaptation. The various adapters plagiarised from one another for the good reason that the resulting mixture of tragic melodrama and broad farce began to prove immensely popular and was cheap to produce and to tour to the country towns. On the stage and in the popular mind, therefore, the literary work Robbery Under Arms had become, in a folkloric sense, an adaptation of a Kelly gang story, despite the fact that they appeared on the stage in reverse order, and that Boldrewood's novel, from which the play was adapted, was scarcely itself based on the Kelly gang story at all. The overarching legend had absorbed them both. Elements of the two stories would continue to weave in and out of one another in the age of film. That's how complicated it gets to work out the relationships of the versions and the successive the adaptations and versions of the adaptations. The 1906 filming of the story of the Kelly Gang is claimed to be the first full-length feature film. 400 feet of it were discovered in 1982, and then in 2006 it was realised that some archive footage in Britain was part of the same work. These are rather blurred for obvious reasons if you know much about silent films. It was realised after that footing was discovered in Britain in 2006 that, you know, possibly they could be put together, there could be a speculative reconstruction of the original. It was attempted and carried out in Canberra and Australia. That editorial effort underlined the fact that silent movie films can only ever partially represent the original experience, since what audiences saw changed with the print of the film actually being projected. The effects of running repairs on the reels of film and the changing use of special effects and voices behind the cloth to give the audience guidance about the silent action, bearing in mind that intertitles seem not to have been used for this film at first. And the situation was complicated in this case by the fact that the British fragment is part of the release print that toured in Britain in late 1907 or 08. The extant Australian fragment may have been corrupted by the incorporation of outtakes not actually used in the film as shown. And the film's synopsis predates some additional material, including a jewellery scene added by 24th January 1907. Here, as in so many cases, editorial and adaptational perspectives overlap one another. But wait, as they say on excited TV advertisements, there's more. The 1906 film was remade in 1910 by Willard Johnson and Millard Gibson, known as J and G. But this version is lost. However, some footage with the J and G insignia in intertitles survives, spliced with continuity, that is, synopsis, from the 1920 Kenneth Rampton filming of what? Robbery Under Arms, not the Kelly Gang, in a real, now titled, retitled, The Kelly Gang. So you get the picture. Here's a few more from these early films. There's the problem of preservation. This is a DVD of clips. Robbery Under Arms, in comparison, was itself filmed three times after World War II. Before World War II, in 1907, 1911, and 1920. Other attempts were stymied by the censorship regime. In 1957, a British film was made as an Australian Western, starring Peter Finch, with a screenplay only occasionally related to the novel. An Australian production was made in 1985, there's a bit more, a bit of a niche, this one, 85, starring Sam Neill, but with far greater fidelity to the novel. But even here, in a scene not in the novel, the priest says of its brother, Jim Marston, after his death, that, quote, he was driven to his death by the British Empire, and the good Lord would take that into account. Do you see? In Bollywood's novel, loyalty to the Empire is never in question. And in a climactic scene near the end of the 1957 film, loyalty is defiantly reinstated. So the opposite sentiment in the 1985 film, in the lead-up to the Australian bicentenary, and with a wave of anti-monarchical small-R republicanism that it unleashed, this represents the Kelly gang story in that small-R republicanism, its anti-monarchical flavour. It represents the Kelly gang story sinking into robbery under arms yet again. Robbery under arms and the Kelly gang have become the yin and yang of one another. In this sense, they are perhaps best considered as two story types deriving from the same folkloric tradition, and therefore always susceptible in any adaptation to what textual critics would call contamination, but what on the stage of film is normal procedure. As a story type, Bollywood's novel inflects the legend towards the conservative side, and the Kelly gang plays inflected towards the radical. In the novel, the Bushranger brothers, Dick and Jim Marston, commit no murders, so their crimes are less heinous. Their beloved mother is Irish Catholic, as in the Kelly family, but their father is defiantly Anglican, thus diffusing the sectarian issue that infuses the Kelly story. The central character whom readers and audiences were invited to admire in Bollywood's novel is Captain Starlight, a colonial black sheep, a gentleman of aristocratic extraction who was hiding his identity. The Kellys, on the other hand, were of bog poor Irish Catholic extraction, and their oppression only continues in Australia. The rejection of the slow route to prosperity by otherwise admirable young men and their gradual steps towards rebellion civil authority was the lure of both Robbery Under Arms and the Kelly gang plays. Both offered the early readers or viewers the luxury of imaginative participation in a rebellion with borders. Outlaws, however rebellious, need to maintain a supporter base if they are to survive. To do this, they need to publicly recognise ethics of conduct, which they generally adopt from existing outlaw traditions, and that their supporters acknowledge. This element is shared between the novel and the Kelly story. The young rebels do not lose touch with the stabilising long-term factors of family, religion and social group. Both story types are about outlawry and rebellion, not revolution. In real life, Ned Kelly went right to the brink, but Bollywood's Marston brothers go nowhere near it. Thus, the spread of identifications offered by the two story types must have been especially effective bolstering the maintenance of that overarching folkloric tradition in the period up until the 1920s. The published histories of the gang were antipathetic to Kelly until 1929. There was no Kelly gang novel readily available, and because of very effective worldwide exploitation of his literary property, Bollywood's novel, in an important sense, substituted for the absence of a Kelly gang novel. It could do this because of its folkloric to it, and part of the novel's commercial success must have been due to a feedback loop from the frequent stagings not only of Robbery Under Arms from 1890 but also of the Kelly gang plays from 1898. When Robbery Under Arms entered into its second demographic flourishing, as I mentioned, after World War II, the Kelly legend flourished with it, and for much the same reasons. The New Zealand born poet David Stewart wrote a play called Ned Kelly in 1943. It received a few stagings soon after the war and was reprinted into the 1960s, finally getting onto school syllabuses, where a young Peter Carey, the novelist, whom I'll get to in a minute, first encountered it. Max Brown published a biography of Ned Kelly, Australian Son, in 1948, based on his painstaking trawl of the oral sources. In the foreword, he consciously links his recent wartime experiences with, quote, the seal of manhood that Ned Kelly and the other young men in his gang justice was yet to be done to Ned Kelly. The matter was a living one for him and his contemporaries, not merely an historical adjudication. The tide was decisively turned. Sidney Nolan began his series of magnificent, nightmarish Ned Kelly paintings in 1946. And Nolan's Ned Kelly is the ironclad bushranger in the armour of his last stand at Glen Rowan in 1880. He is a man become a machine of war, already a looming two-dimensional icon in the Australian landscape, the living man reduced to a pair of eyes behind the armour, a slit in the headpiece, otherwise transparent. In the paintings, he has traded his life for iconicity. It was a potent icon, but the paintings also register the personal cost. The strain of this deformation probably reflects the existential anxieties of the new post-war atomic age climate. In the introduction in 1954 to a new Collins edition of Robbery Under Arms, G.F. Main will comment in reflecting on, quote, the Holocaust of two world wars, the Iron Curtain, the apocalyptic power of atomic weapons, that it is no surprise that we, quote, should turn for relief to a century when life was relatively uninhibited, when even lawlessness was uncomplex surface ground. The Ned Kelly story and Robbery Under Arms had become folkloric symbols, exfoliations of the same still with inevitably, the sting went out of this cultural nationalist appropriation in due course. By the 1960s, the living connection to 1880 was palpably failed. And by about 1965, the commodification of Ned Kelly had begun. In the 1970s, he became an object of respectable historical scholarship, which has continued to this day. It has involved a wider contextualizing and thorough mining archives. One might have thought that the process was now over. Robbery Under Arms went out of print in the second half of the 1990s, probably for the first time since the 1940s. Ned Kelly could, of course, continue to be exploited for tourists. There is also, I must say, a Big Ned statue at Glen Rowan. That's the place of his last stand, along with various tourist museums. And he was used in advertising fine wines from the district in which he lived, now often called Kelly Country. But that only confirms, this all only confirms that a horse can continue to be flogged for some time. For all other intents and purposes, Ned could now be safely relegated to a historic trace, a mere sentimentality, and the folkloric tradition would in Australia need to find another story type for its continuation. Well, one could have thought that until the appearance of Peter Carey's impressive novel, True History Kelly Gang in 2000. It won the Booker Prize in 2001. A new typesetting of Robbery Under Arms appeared in Australia in 2001, also from a small commercial publisher, Axiom, in Adelaide. I'll just go back to that one. You might be able to see something through the lawyer's attention. Suddenly there were significant exhibitions about Ned Kelly being mounted in museums, and a new grimly beautiful Ned Kelly film starring Heath Ledger and Orlando Bloom was screened in 2003. Max Brown's biography of Ned Kelly that I mentioned, Australian Sun, was reprinted in 2005, and for the first time since 1980, and my Academy edition of Robbery Under Arms appeared in 2006. Carey's novel was probably the most important of its size. You know, the Kelly Gang and Robbery Under Arms story types can be seen once again, to have doubled back on one another. Carey has done what Bollywood so innovatively achieved in the 1880s, that is, the invention, or really the reinvention, of the bushranger's voice. Here are a few pages from his typescript. The green is his editor. Like Robbery Under Arms, Carey's novel is also a first-person narrative, ostensibly written by Ned in semi-literate prose. Although it has been characterised as a piece of clever postmodern quotation, the novel is more fundamentally a sustained act of the most historically informed and imaginatively developed. Although Carey does not mention it in the novel's afterword or acknowledgements, its inspiration was, without doubt, Ned Kelly's famous Jerusalem letter. This part dictated by this unlettered man to Joe Byrne, a member of Kelly's gang, played by Orlando Bloom, by the way, in the movie. The Jerusalem letter was meant to be an intervention in what Kelly knew to be the dominant print culture. He wanted it to publish. He wanted to defend publicly his being forced to kill the three policemen, which had caused him to be outlawed. Robin Hood-like, he needed to save face amongst his growing following, and he darkly threatened revenge and rebellion, some colonial strategy, as he called it, if his plea was not heard. In his reinvention of the bushranger's voice, Carey weaves phrases and sentences taken from the Jerilderie letter, but so seamlessly that they are hard to detect. Yet the Jerilderie letter and the available biographical and historical scholarship on Kelly could only get Carey so far. What he must have realised was that if he could invent the voice, if he could invent the voice, if P. Carey could perform it with utter inwardness, everything else would follow, since it would have to inhabit and therefore be conditioned by the same linguistic environment. Idiom and presentation would be everything, just as they would for Mark Twain, who was writing Huck Finn at much the same time as Voldemort was enjoying the freedoms of inhabiting Dick Marston's voice. Carey's novel needs to be thought of as an adaptation, one more exfoliation of that living tree, the folkloric tradition around Kelly. It is better not to think of Carey's novel as a version, or here I disagree with Verna, or as a revision, because I think we need those terms for naming variations within the world. It's better, I believe, to think of it as an adaptation. Partly because adaptations can themselves be versional. As bibliography is there to remind us, and especially if we take readers' experiences of the adapted work to consider as part of it. So finally, there's a bit more from the alternate type to manuscript. You can see how busy the editor was. Okay. So finally, to some theoretical observations. In his monograph of 2002 called Fluid Text, John Bryant defines the work as a, quote, flow of energy. This striking formulation emerges from a lucid critique of intentionalist and materialist decisions. In both, Bryant observes, the work is both essentially a product or set of products, not a process. What he calls the ontology of process reveals a deeper principle, he believes, that he calls fluid text. It supersedes the two positions, the intentionalist and the materialist, and leaves the editor-critic free to interpret the, quote, psychological and cultural principles manifested in acts of revision of versions of the work. These acts in this book are Bryant's primary focus. Since then, Bryant has moved on to adaptation. In a chapter that appeared in the collection Adaptation Studies in 2013, he declares that to incorporate the phenomenon of adaptation, an even broader definition necessary, one that both embraces all versions of the text, including its sources and adaptations, and quote, all forms of revision, both authorial and cultural. Well, when I read this, I thought this is heady stuff, particularly coming from a Melbourne editor, as Brian is best known for. The problem he creates, I think, is that in order to analyse this flow of energy, we need to be able to name the entities we are describing, and know their boundaries in order to differentiate them. Otherwise, we cannot understand one as a development of the other, or as a remaking of the other, linked by shared subject matter. As we also need to allow for the fact that all these works, both original and adapted, may have versions of themselves recorded in various documents, and that those versions may have undergone revision quite separately from the original work from which the adaptation came, it's imperative that we preserve the work concept, the version concept, and the revision concept for their ordinary usages. Failing to do this with his fluid text and flow of energy metaphors, Ryan, I think, is leading us up the garden path. He does recognise that we still need to differentiate both what he calls the textual, textual identities of the original and adapted texts, so that's good. But he doesn't see that this need is left in opposition to his essentialised fluid text idea. He does not offer a model that would accommodate and relate the two. So, when Bryant goes so far as to claim that adaptation can be edited, that there is such a thing as transmedial editing, as he did at the Society for Textual Scholarship conference in Ottawa last April, the editor in me shakes his head and asks, how could such a potentially good idea in fluid text go so wrong? Bryant's description of a software tool that has been developed in his Melbourne lab at Hofstra University shows that by editing he means adaptation. The workspace tool he's developing, which is very interesting, I suggest you look at it, this workspace tool allows passages in source texts to be linked to passages in the recipient text and commented on, and similarly for passages in adaptations in other media. I imagine that such linkages, being data, could then be visualised as sinuous and ever-changing lines of connection of varying bits from one work to another. I'd welcome such an outcome, of course, but it's not scholarly editing that Brian claims it is. Its central concern is that is scholarly editing has traditionally been the establishment of texts of works or versions to which annotation and commentary is added, performing a supportive or supplementary role. Brian, it seems to me, is what the car before the course. These remarks have been prompted by a book that Vernon very helpfully led me to, Linda Hutchins, A Theory of Adaptation, that we mentioned today, in which towards the end, Linda Hutchins gives some attention to Bryant's work. I'll turn to the results of Hutchins' encounter shortly, but first I want to query whether her book offers the cogent theoretical underpinning that the still emerging field of adaptation study requires. I'm going to say some good things about Hutchins in a minute, but first let me say that I don't think this book fits the bill, for it isn't really a theory of adaptation at all. Rather, Hutchins' approach is predominantly descriptive and categorising. She expertly lays on the table an encyclopedic range of adaptations, and then shows how they fit into the pre-announced categories of tell, show, and participate. But that does not by itself amount to a theory, that's a taxonomy. There are understandable grudges animating Hutchins' inquiry, such as the old criterion for success of an adaptation being its fidelity to the original. She's also keen to dislodge not so much the concept of as a hypothetical evaluation of originality. She needs to get fidelity and originality out of the way so that adaptation study can find its own feet. But what will those feet extend to? We get only glimpses of possible answers, and then the ideas are generally quoted from others. What we don't get is a high-level model of adaptation in terms of which her categories pursued throughout the book might make sense. Bryant's work suggests to her one of those glimpsed answers. As an editor and editorial theorist, he points to the operations on texts in production, carried out by censors, boundarizers, editors, to which I would add amanuenses, typists, typesetters, all must read the text before they alter it for their particular purpose. That is to say, these agents of textuality do, just as every other reader will after publication, participate in the work by virtue of their reception of this text. Only the professional few then go on to change it. Their interventions materialise in new or altered documents. Scholarly editors have always had to deal with this phenomenon. So, from Bryant, Hutchins takes on the idea of reception-generating changes. This leads her, in turn, to suggest a reception continuum. Can this promising hunch be taken further? 4 years ago, in my book Securing the Past, I proposed a model that might give it assistance, what I called the production-reception continuum, a slider, if you like, along which all participating textual agents in the work could be positioned along with material outcomes of their agency. Editors typically deal with the production end, but at the reception end, readers often record comments on the work they're reading with marginalia. Some few of them may go on to write a separately published review, a parody, even a journal article, a book chapter. Sometimes successive waves of reviewing occur as later reviewers respond to earlier ones. Fans let rip in fanzines and blogs. In every such case, the act of reception engenders a materialized act of production of a new work that, in turn, may give rise to its reception, and so on. The new production may be in a different genre or medium, and therefore subject to a different set of formal conventions. Or not. In whatever form it takes, the adaptation becomes part of the works of the original work's afterlife, just as the original work may be considered part of the adaptation's prehistory. In other words, the adaptation establishes a new production reception continuum slider of its own, which either stops right there because the new work is ignored, or itself fertilely endows newer adaptations. The new slider, while still touching the first, shifts away from it as it takes on its own textual and cultural trajectory. It remains substantively linked to the first by virtue of its transformation of at least some of its original subject matter. Any subsequent adaptation may further depart company from the original by cleaving to the second's choice of subject matter, or it may revert to the original's, rating for what, in the new moment of production, seems likely to grant it a new theory, another reception. Looked at most generally, reception engenders production, but the new production will be subject to the different cultural valences of its time and place. When and where it must establish its own readership or audience or participating user base. In this model, notice that adaptation depends upon the underlying model of the work. Hutchett is wise to insist that adaptations be defined as extensive revisitations of prior works. Because it is at the level of the work, I suggest, that we are operating. Further, her definition of adaptation, again wisely in my opinion, rules out sources, allusions, echoes, etc., such as Bryant wants to include within his definitely elastic concept of fluid text. She's also wise to insist on the relevance for adaptation study of the intention of the original creator and adapter. Textual critics are fellow travellers here, for the good reason that the phenomenon that they are studying, textual variation among versions of the work, needs to be empirically explained. Individual human agency may not be the ideal way forward, but it's better in the sense of prompting you to ask more particularised questions than any other show. The same explanatory burden, the same intellectual predicament, obtains for adaptation critics the need to explain variation or difference. The temptation to slide out of it by invoking the idea of cultural revision, as Brian does, as if cultural were the agent, and as Hutchett is tempted to do, and I must admit, as I have myself also entertained at times, as a sufficient explanatory mode in itself, should, I think, be resisted. It's passive voice shorthand, cultural revision. It's passive voice shorthand obscures the fact that people, not cultures, create works that are materialized on documents. Every such act of creation and reception is, of course, inflected by the cross-cultural currents of the day and place, inevitably. But to the extent that the term revision involves and necessitates the materialized production of a text, there is no getting around the agentive nature of textuality, either within works or across them. At times in her restless book, Hutchin recognises this condition, which is proper to textual studies. I wish it were more widely engaged with. As I read the book, I began to think that had Hutchin been on better terms with editorial theory, a better understanding of a common or at least closely allied problem and purpose might have emerged, one that would be mutually enriching for both areas of study, of what we might together call replication and variation. Is it too late to start now? I hope I've begun to suggest that. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that detailed, informative, fascinating, and thought-provoking talk, which indeed is always a very interesting direction. And to begin those directions, we have have the two panelists with us here today. First, Ian Cornelius. Ian is a research SJ associate professor of medieval literature and culture in the Department of English here at Loyola. His book, Reconstructing Illicit in Verse, The Pursuit of the Medieval Reader, will be published by
I think Paul for the invitation to respond to his insightful paper and for his labors of organizing these late findings in the provides such an important institutional and communal function. And thanks to Gunnar as well for giving us today his topic of adaptation. A couple of years ago, I contributed a chapter on Aristides' constellation philosophy for the Cambridge History of Classical Conception in English literature. So my first task here was to decide what works to include the constellation of philosophy, an enormous and influential work of the antiquity that spawned entire genres of visionary literature, personification, allegory, didactic dialogue. Where would I draw the boundaries in order to tell a history? And adaptation played a key role in my thinking of that, those boundaries, but with controls. As controls on an adaptation of this work, I introduced the gloss and the translation as well. So that I talk about a adaptation, translation, gloss triangle, and the history of the works that appear within that triangular space. Anyway, this hearing talks today and preparing these remarks in response to Paul's paper has been thinking again about what adaptation meant for me in that history. I begin these remarks by drawing attention to Paul's closing mood in his paper. His suggestion that textual studies and adaptation studies may share a common object or target within the party. Is replication and variation of literary works. This closing statement is itself a variation on Linda Hutchins' definition of adaptation, quoted by Paul at the beginning of his paper. Hutchins defines adaptation as replication and revision in the passage quoted by Paul. So, a definitional formula that undergoes a certain variation, or is a revision, between its first appearance and its second. What's at stake? Revision may be large in scale, as in a wholesale reworking of a received text, or very small, as in a program of spelling correction. In either case, revision designates a mode of textual engagement that is guided by some regulative idea or design. The term variation directs us preferentially to small-scale changes, but nevertheless may be more capacious of these two terms, encompassing both designed and non-designed change. While only still agent-like revisions, textual variants, variations, differ from revision in that they include as well as various categories of non-designed or inadvertent change that may creep into the text during replication. The real difference between these two terms may, however, be their provenance. Revision, I think of it, revision stems from the production side of Paul's production reception continuum. Its native habitat is the writer's desk or desktop. That is, revision is prototypically what authors do to their own writing, and then the concept may be extended from that prototypical instance to cover formally similar modes of textual engagement with writing not one's own, and thence to adaptation. Variation, by contrast, is a word that stems from the practice of textual editing, and specifically from collation of witnesses to a literary work. In these several respects, from semantics to pragmatic and discursive implication and provenance, terms of variation and revision are meaningfully differentiated. Substitution of one for the other in the definition of statement may confirm that adaptation studies and textual studies are independent endeavors, even if it is possible to describe them in roughly parallel ways. Paul's references to folkloric tradition are, I think, instructive in this connection. I'll remind you of a few key formulations. So he states that by the middle of the 20th century, the Ned Kelly story and Robin Under Arms were, quote, had become, quote, folkloric siblings. Peter Carey's novel, The True History of the Kelly Gang, published in 2000, quote, deserves to be thought of as an adaptation, one more exfoliation of the living tree, the folkloric tradition around Ned Kelly. And a last quote at a higher, more generalizing level. Two story types deriving from the same folkloric tradition are susceptible, writes, to what the textual critics would call contamination, but what, at the stage and in film, is normal procedure. What's the function of the folklore in this analysis? It seems to me that it functions as a force field, or a matrix of diffuse and uncontextualized semiosis within which discrete literary works come into being, are replicated and revised. That analytic role seems to be justified and also significant in connection to our conference theme. But as far as I can see, the term folklore is a tantum quid in this discussion, belonging neither to textual studies nor to adaptation studies. The presence of folkloric traditions then this discussion may suggest that textual studies and adaptation studies join the same general plane of literary analysis that takes in a whole array of other aspects of literary works and the study of them, namely sources, genre, medium, allusion, some measure of cultural implication, such as the folklore. Hutchin excludes most of these aspects of literary textuality in the purview of adaptation studies. I offer no challenge to that, except to wonder whether adaptation studies can be joined with textual studies without ushering all those other aspects of literary textuality back into the room at the same time. It would be necessary to talk here about translation as well, for the interlingual replication of literary works. To wrap up, my suggestion is just that the union of textual studies and adaptation appears to occur at a logical plane in which textual studies joins a comprehensive study of the literary work, inclusive of its sources, genre, allusions, and indeed the folkloric exterior. This is admittedly a complex theoretical landscape, but it answers to the complexity of the phenomenon find in literary works and literary traditions, as illustrated so well by Paul's account of robbery under arms in the Ned Kelly story.
Our second respondent is Grace Stevens. Grace is a second year doctoral student, the president of the Graduate Student Council, and the assistant director of Loyola's Writing Center. Her recent research on narrative theory and textual studies has been published in Evelyn Waugh Studies and the Thomas Hodgkin.
Thank you, Dr. Foster, and thank you, Dr. Eggert, for your wonderful paper. In Ned Kelly's drawery letter, the mid-19th century Australian bushranger dictated to another member of the Kelly gang his justification for his actions, particularly in regards to his murdering three policemen in 1878, the prior year. It is a letter not unconcerned with the ongoing social discourse about the corruption of police officers, whom Kelly colorfully describes as, quote, a person with big, ugly, fat-necked, wombat-headed, big-bellied magpie, lean, narrow hips, sloth-footed sons of Irish bailiffs or English landlords. End quote. The letter is, as Dr. Eggert describes it, an intervention in what Kelly knew to be the dominant prayer culture. The distinguishing facet of this letter, this text, that I believe might enrich our conversation about harmonizing the receiving points of conjunction between editorial theory and the theory of adaptation, would be the oral character of this written text. The written text of the unlettered Ned Kelly reads with the characteristics of spoken language, perhaps a byproduct of its being dictated to his amanuensis, Joe Byrne, or of the letter coming out of these rolling discussions amongst the gang members. The linguistic structures of this grammatically challenged letter reveal, to invoke, what's wrong, the differences between orality and literacy, between the languages of oral and literate cultures. In the text, Kelly and Byrne, who we might say is, of course, another agent of the text production, favor aggregative rather than analytic language, which is at times cumbersome and redundant, albeit diverting. As the incidents of the past year are narrated, the text stays naturally close to the human world lived experience, rather than the theoretical. It additionally underscores the context of human struggle and evokes the empathetic imagination. All went on to describe as characteristics of the thought and expressions of an oral culture, as opposed to literate. So both textual studies and theories of adaptation, in the broadest sense, must embrace an underlying assumption, or stated or unstated, of what is a the ever vexed question, and one that Dr. Eggert, of course, addresses in his towards his concluding remarks. Throughout the article, Dr. Eggert refers to the larger folkloric tradition that a work participates in particularly in this case, the works replicating and revising the social bandit legend. This folkloric tradition, assumedly both spoken, written, of course, offers a sort of oral work that generates these chronic substantiations of the legend, and that cannot be excised from the life of the work, or indeed from the very origins of the work. In his research for his 1948 biography of Ned Kelly, Australian's son, Max Brown, as Eggert notes, painstakingly trolls these oral sources, respecting their primacy in the life of the work. So if we consider the work's oral life, I see a disjuncture between Eggert's impulse to honor or consider the folkloric tradition of which I refer to as the oral ur text, and yet his insistence on, quote, the imperative that we preserve the work concept, that we are able to name the entities we are describing and know their boundaries in order to differentiate them, thereby pushing against John Bryant's definition of the work as a flow of energy, fluid text. I'll agree, Bryant's borderless definition of the work is concerningly anemic. But how do we, or would, or should we, police the boundaries of a work's oral life? How do we neatly demarcate where different versions of a folkloric tradition spill into one another? And do we need to? When Dr. Eggert asks, how does materiality affect meaning, I can't help but wonder how the immaterial, or oral life of the work, affects its meaning and transmission as it is replicated and revised over time. These are perhaps not useful questions for the rigid scholarly editor as he or she executes the production of a new edition of a work. But considering how we privilege or make sense of the oral origins of a work would shift or color our underpinning theoretical assumptions as we move towards a mutually enriching alliance for textual studies and the theory of adaptations.
Mary Lutz, who is a second-year PhD student at Loyola. She's currently studying the non-dramatic poetry and prose of the early modern period in preparation for the comps. Her most recent endeavors include her forthcoming presentation of her paper Challenging Accessibility, The Radical Devastator of Aaron Sawyer's The Vineyard at the 2017 Drama Conference, and the publication of her master's project in the latest edition.
Eggert. Thank you for your paper. Reading and listening to your argument has introduced me to a folklore that I was unfamiliar with, and I'm actually surprised that I wasn't familiar with it, what with my love of Sam Neill, Heath Ledger, and Orlando Bloom. But because I have more familiarity with adaptation and cultural adaptation theory and Linda Hutchins' work, I want to focus on the later portion of your essay regarding theory and adaptation. Near the end of the essay, you have written, the temptation to slide out of it or the explanation of variation or difference by invoking the idea of cultural revision as a sufficient explanatory mode in itself should be resisted. And you further emphasize that reflecting on culture as a stimulus for adaptation necessarily denotes passivity, as well as overlooks the fact that, quote, people, not cultures, create works materialized on documents, unquote. And there's no doubt that people are the agents which create works, but the problematic nature of the question you raise, as I see it, is a suggestion that somehow individuals can be able to be consciously aware of the influence of culture in their daily thoughts and activities. Is it possible, then, for people to escape the influence of their own culture as they undergo the processes of creativity? Moreover, your emphasis on an Australian folklore creates an interesting situation in my mind regarding cultural adaptation, because most of the adaptations you've discussed are adaptations written or produced by other Australians. And in this, I will readily accept your observations that Robbery Under Arms is adapted from, or at least strongly connected to, the Ned Kelly legend. With that being said, most of the various editions and adaptations of Robbery Under Arms, originally written by Rolf Walterwood or Thomas Alexander Brown, an Australian author, are also Australian adaptations, including the 1985 film that you mentioned, which was produced by the South Australian Film Corporation. The 1906 silent film, The Sword of the Kelly Gang, is also dubbed as an Australian work. Skipping ahead to more modern adaptations, Robert Drew, the author of the 1991 adapted novel Our Sunshine, of which you footnote, is an Australian novelist. Drew's influence extended to two more adaptations, Carrie's novel and the 2003 Ned Kelly film. Drew's novel holds Peter Carey's endorsement. Quote, an important writer meets an important myth and reinvents it in the most sensual, visceral language that he has yet produced, to forever change the way we see Ned Kelly, end quote. Our Sunshine was also the primary source for the 2003 Ned Kelly film starring Orlando Bloom and Heath Ledger. That film was also directed by an Australian, Gregor Jordan. Eben Carey, the author of The True History of the Kelly Gang, published in 2000, is Australian. In fact, one of the only adaptations that's mentioned in the paper, which is not Australian, the 1957 British adaptation of Robbery Under Arms, is critiqued as, quote, only occasionally related to the novel, end quote, and is furthermore compared to the later Australian adaptation and stating that the latter later version had far greater fidelity at that point. You know, it goes without saying that the primary interest in the Ned Kelly mythos would be from Australians themselves, since this is where the folklore was birthed. Although, as you've related, the influence of earlier folklores like Robin Hood can't be overlooked either. However, it seems to me that your criticism on the potential for cultural influence on adaptation might be misplaced based on the adaptations that have been analyzed. To be clear, Australian culture clearly influenced the production of these numerous adaptations, so I'm not attempting to dismiss the various cultural inflections that you note within Australian culture that have been manifested in the various Australian adaptations of the Ned Kelly folklore. But the effect and even existence of cultural influence on adaptation, as Hutchins insinuates in her transcultural section of the theory of adaptation, is much more obvious when we translate across cultures rather than within a single culture. Although concessions for temporal evolutions in a society's culture must be accounted for, perhaps the most striking differences we note in our own cultures are made when we compare them to different cultures, rather than noting changes within the same one over time. In the case of the 1957 British adaptation of Robbery Under Arms, I wonder if creative alterations that occurred might have been a result of cultural adaptation. As Hutchins notes, borrowing Susan Stanford Friedman's anthropological terminology, intercultural adaptation or indigenization occurs when people, quote, pick and choose what they want to transplant to their own soil, and adapters of traveling stories exert power over what they adapt, end quote. Could it be that any variants from the original novel, which you seem to infer as unfaithful through reference, which is the kind of comparison that Hutchin argues is a disservice to adaptations as works in themselves, could it be that these variations might have been as much because of transcultural influence or even intercultural adaptation? At the very least, we can't deny Australian culture has perpetuated the Ned Kelly folklore in a really significant way. But more broadly, can we fairly dismiss the influence of culture on adaptation in general when we are only focusing on works within a single culture?
Questions
and comments?
Oh, yes, certainly.
By
all means. Have a go.
there were great responses. I begin to think that the call I made in the last couple of sentences for a coming together or theorizing the coming together of adaptation study and textual studies is already happening, so that's great, and also clear that there are differences of opinion, as there should be. So that I really can't about that. The question Grace brought up of the oral character that can underlie the life of the work, I think is really important. She then asked the question from that, can such a work have boundaries if its life is particularly in an oral rather than a recorded form? And after all, it's quite true to say that the textual studies is linked very firmly to materialized documents of one kind or another. They can be on screen, of course, as well as on paper. That said, of course, textual studies has dealt with ballads for some centuries, and has used textual studies methods for dealing with variation in the appearance of the same ballad. Ballads, of course, are so readily adapted by their performers and differently remembered by the hearers. Ballads, in that sense, do have a continuous, well, it's not quite evolution, but dissemination, let's say, and they're undergoing continuous change. So I think that that's true. The oral character of the Jerilderie letter is plain, as Grace pointed out. You've just got to listen to it, and you can hear that it was dictated. But oddly enough, I think it was not only dictated, I suspect it was actually a collaborative dictation, and that series of that invective about Victorian police that Grace quoted, you can just hear one member of the gang comes up with Splore for another one comes up with and Pig Bellied, and so it just you can just hear it happening, and yet there's Joe Byrne trying to get it down. In fact, it was played like that in the Mick Jagger version of adaptation of the Ned Kelly story back in the black and white one back in the 60s.
It's on YouTube.
Yeah.
Something to do with
it. So I guess, you know, what with New York publishers for Peter Carey, who is an Australian but has lived in the States for decades. With Jagger and Peter Finch, and I could go on. The Australian folklore around this, I think, has disseminated But it is, as Mary says, it was given birth to in Australia. But in being given birth, it did, of course, have to appropriate the overarching Robin Hood myth, which the folklore around Robin Hood is has to be relevant, because it is relevant to any outlaw bushranger. If you think of Jesse James or Bill the Kid, it's the same. But they operate under the same conditions. They're having to maintain a support base of some kind. Well, they just can't live it for very much longer. They'll be caught. They're having to show daring and courage, because that's the way you maintain a support base. They do have to steal, partly in order to give money away to that support base, or the same fate awaits them as awaits all the others. So, in fact, with Billy the Kid, there's a Marlon Brando movie of about 1960, 61. I think it's called, is it Eyes Jack or One Eyes Jack?
One Eye Jacks.
One Eye Jacks, that's it, yeah. So that's not actually about Billy the Kid, but it is about a character called the Kid, which there is a novel underlying that, that film, which was written in about 1956, it's a Charles Nider and so that novel is itself a retelling of the Billy the Kid story, but shifted to California around Monterey. And Billy the Kid, well, I've forgotten his name in the novel, he's no longer Billy, but you can see the sort of thing that I'm talking about. Of course, it's going to involve banks, rustling, the normal stuff. And I can tell you that I was in Joshua Tree National Park last week, and I found a place called the Hidden Valley. And this Hidden Valley was used from the late 1870s by the McCaney gang to squirrel away their horses that they had stolen from various ranches in Arizona and in the desert valleys of California. So Joshua Tree National Park, or Joshua Tree Area National Park in those days, was fairly high up. So they would get the horses, they would keep them in Hidden Valley. It was almost impossible to find this valley. They would rebrand them. That's exactly what happens in Robbery Under Arms, except instead of being called Hidden Valley, it's called Terrible Hollow, and it's extremely hard to get in, get to find it, but once you're in there, it's an inn. So there's a kind of international tissue of reference and of source and of understanding. It's kind of an oral culture thing, really, and it's there. That's what leads me really to invoke folkloric story time, of which I think the Ned Kelly is really a subtype, which then itself fertilely endows many manifestations. And lastly, the manifestation word is an interesting one. Although I don't go this way myself, and I'm still trying to think through, and I'm unsure of myself really on this, but in the library world, there is a way of dealing with adaptations. Librarians have practical problems when it comes to cataloguing, describing, and cataloguing. Their conventions and assumptions were inherited from 19th century book-based objects, which needed to be catalogued. If they can't catalogue, they can't be accessed. You may as well not have them. So cataloguing is essential to the endeavour of this building we're in. By the late 1990s, the library world had realised that the Anglo-American cataloguing rules were no longer serving them as well as they needed to, because of the types of cultural materials that needed to be described in some catalog and needed to be related to one another. And so they came up with a computer model, which is effectively a hierarchy, and it goes work, expression, and work is a conceptual entity, expression is a conceptual entity. You might read work version onto that. and their manifestations are concrete, in which case you might read it as a production of a version of the work. And then the last one is the item on the shelf. So it's work, expression, manifestation, item. So you can see how a computer loves this kind of thing because it's good and hierarchical. And then the way they make it malleable is to set up relationships so that an adaptation is not in this work expression hierarchy. It's another work in itself, and a translation is another work in itself. But they can all be linked at the level of subject matter, and it's that relationship. It's the relationships between the levels in the hierarchy that's the crucial matter. So it's as you heard, I went for the kind of folkloric convention to try and find a way of understanding this cluster of works around the Ned Kelly story. But I think the library world it's called actually FBAR, the functional requirements for bibliographic records. It emerged about 2000, so that's a different way of trying to handle, the same problem. And I'm not quite sure if there's more thinking done about this problem. I'm not sure in which way it will finally pan out.
I think I would have to say it's rather sobering thought if it all comes down to something
of a folklore tradition as being an immaterial kind of idea. And I think that connects in a really nice way to what Dr. Cornelius was saying too about folklore as being a force field idea. I think that's such a wonderful way of talking about it because I think folklore is hard to categorize in that it's something that it's shared but it's not necessarily specific either. And so I think that's a nice way of kind of marrying the idea between that folklore as being an immaterial while also being substantive. There's a weird way of trying to conceptualize that, so I really appreciate your idea of it being a force field. I think that's a new way of considering that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you as well, because that was just an extraordinary mapping of a whole series of iterations around this folklore. And I'm kind of trapped between two different models, and one is T.S. Eliot's tradition, and the work of great art alters everything that's come before, but thinking about a field as well. So the idea then of this sort of spatial configuration. But then also Star Wars. What it means to have a canon to this constantly being expanded and stretched by fans and productions. So I'm really interested in some ways the Australian sort of focus of this I was thinking of 2 weeks ago, I realized that my almost 18-year-old daughter has never seen any of the earlier Star Treks, the series, Star Trek, Next Generation, and all that. So when we talk about basically stories that are told and retold, so within the Australian context, the Hero Generation, for example, as your first contact, is there really still a very prevalent awareness of that? Obviously,
that's an interesting one. He keeps on coming up in the conservative press, the Rupert Murdoch press in Australia. About once every 2 months or so, there'll be an op-ed which will get stuck into anybody who believes or that Ned Kelly was a hero. So it's sort of alive at that level. He's very much alive in the oral culture. It's some sort of question of police brutality or shooting of police or that sort of thing. It's Ned Kelly is the go-to reference. I'm just thinking of my own children, they have the advantage or disadvantage of having me as their father, so they know about Ned Kelly. And in fact, I have to tell you, if you allow me one self-indulgent anecdote, the Gerildery letter was only resurfaced in what was it, about 2003, I think it was. It was given to the State Library of Victoria. So I went down there to look at it, and I thought, oh, I think I need to write about this. And then the next time I got to see it, my family was with me. So I took the children with me. I guess they were about 20 or so at the time. The older one, late teens. And I said, well, this is it. And the bits of paper are only about that big. And the thing is, the ink changes colour. Because the paper's so small, it's probably the only kind of paper they could get. They might have been writing while they were on the run, or possibly in caves. My son in particular was really moved by it. So it's an interesting thing. But that, in the wider culture, yes, those ads I pulled out. One of them was from an airline magazine, and it was 10 years ago maybe. I just pulled it out, tore it out, she did. Or did I liberate them? No, I think I liberated them. So it's around. Certainly the tourism industry in that part of Victoria absolutely loves Ned Kelly because there's money to be made. There's been a lot of investment by local businesses put into it. I think the Peter Carey novel helped a lot. The Orlando Bloom, Heath Ledger, helped a lot. Although it would have helped more had it been a more popular film, but it wasn't a blockbuster. I don't think there's any danger of the legend dying. Not for quite a while.
Thanks very much to everybody. I have a comment which is long and a question which is short. The comment is a request that we seek to complicate this binary between oral and lexical texts. Obviously, Ned Kelly is hopeful of Walter. The novel being the younger of the older novel tries to come across as an oral text, but it's not. And I couldn't help noticing when you put the pages of Peter Carey up in front of us that his editor was trying very hard to make him sound more like an oral text, even though this is a book that's going to go on to win the Booker Prize. You don't get much more literary than that. I won't tell anecdotes right now, we'll be happy to tell them at the lunch. But my own students and biological children relate to literature, I would say, almost entirely as if it were folklore. Because their knowledge of it is not textual, it's not specific, it's not particularly lexical, it's about stuff. It's the matter of Romeo and Juliet, you might say, or the matter of Star Wars or Star Trek. I don't know how typical my children and students are compared to yours, but I think there are more than one model out there that we might be thinking. This leads to my question, which is very short. When we talk about, and you brought this up, Paul, but several other people have talked about it since then, when we talk about a coming together of adaptation studies and textual studies, are we talking about a synthesis, a congruence, a confluence, or a dialogue?
That's a good one. Well, you're pushing me further past where I am at the present in my thinking about this. I doubt that it can become a congruence or even a confluence without without theoretical work being done. That is to say, that we need an overarching theory that that properly and sensibly relates them. Obviously, they're not the same thing. I think that's commonsensical, but they seem to have parallel problems, and maybe they're just different. In some cases, anyway, they're going to be different parts of one another. The reason I mentioned, or the reason I argued that we need to hang on to the word concept, word inversion, concepts, it is obviously that adaptations, if you allow that they're words, can have versions of themselves. And the moment there are versions, textual studies has a role to play. Textual studies also deals with many works which have not been adapted. In fact, that would be the majority. So I would have thought, you may dispute that, but I'd like to hear how. I think that with adaptation, we're dealing, as Linda Hutchins claimed, with replication and revision, or as Ian very nicely pointed out, and like an editorial sleuth, I had to go straight back to, did I really write that? I said replication and variation. So I had varied, as he pointed out, the very thing which I quoted earlier in the essay. So the moment, if it's true, if it's acceptable that replication and revision, or replication and variation, are reasonable shorthand descriptions of adaptation study on the one hand, textual studies on the other, then we're close. You know, we're close. We're not the same thing. The two fields are not the same thing, and that's why I call for more thinking about this, more theorising of it. Because I think my paper is merely it's a start, but that's all. Thank you.
Thank you again for the book, paper, and the there's something I often think about with adaptation. I can't remember where I got it, but it might actually have been Hutchian. That there's an important distinction, I think, to be made between the noun and the verb adaptation. And this is something that I started to talk about earlier, and I think that Ann Shanahan really nailed, which is that someone might be doing the work of adaptation and result in something that is not itself an adaptation. And I wonder if there's some similarity between addition and editing that get into what you were talking about, that you were saying that the fluid text starts to talk about calling this addition. And I would say that what he was doing was editorial, or was editing, but the thing he ended up with was not an addition, it was an annotation. I wonder if that's another thing that adaptation and textual criticism have in common, is that we tend to use the word and not specify whether, always specify whether we're using it as a verb or a noun.
This is actually why I pointed you to the workspace lab of John Bryan's Hofstra University, because it does appear to me, in fact, I've been meaning to say this to you for about a month or two, the importance of annotation. Now I'm talking about this as sort of annotation in operation, and annotation has been a way to link one adaptation to another, or an adaptation to its source text. It's something which Bryan has put in place, and it might be a way forward for adaptation studies, particularly perhaps at the class level within the educational environment, because it does allow a whole range of people, not just the specialists, the scholars, to observe and record the links and variations between an original work and adaptation, and subsequent adaptations. And once the data is input, then it becomes possible to analyze it and lastly to visualize it. And then that starts to the useful thing about and the sort of analysis and visualization, I think, is that it helps you or prompts you to ask questions which you hadn't asked in the first place. It sets up paradigms and norms which you can then problematize. But that's I think is a way of perhaps just saying that of the editorial enterprise, maybe it's annotation that is central to adaptation studies. I don't know, I want to think about that.
And I think we have to, for his not because we're already over time, so we continue the discussion over lunch.